So the last time we met, we derived the rotations from the geographic coordinate system to the wellbore coordinate system. Okay? So we actually derived those equations. We're not going to re-derive them today. But if you remember, now we have two additional angles that take us down into the coordinate system of the wellbore, right? So we're given the principal stresses in some arbitrary oriented frame. We do a rotation into the geographic coordinate system. That's the same rotation we used when we talked about faults, okay? So, or it's sort of this unrotation, right? So we unrotate from wherever the principal stresses are oriented into the geographic frame. And now that we're in the geographic frame, we rotate down into the wellbore. And that rotation is characterized by two angles, delta here, which is the azimuth, okay, the azimuth of the toe of the wellbore, and phi, which is the angle of deviation, right? And it goes from vertical to horizontal. So if phi is 0, it's a vertical well. If phi is 90, it's a horizontal well. Okay? So this is phi here. So again, it's easiest to think about delta if you think about horizontal well. It's sort of easiest to visualize. So if this is north and you drill a horizontal well, and let's say that the toe of the well is projected like this. The azimuth of the toe of the well is pointed, say, 45 degrees from north. Then that's delta. The same would be true if it's a deviated well. Okay. So there's the rotation matrix. We derived it last time. That takes us from the geographic coordinate system into the wellbore. And so if we're then given S, which S is just the principal stresses, a diagonal matrix of the principal stresses, we can use the rotation matrix from the geographic frame to rotate into the stress into the geographic frame, SG. And then we can use this rotation matrix, RB, to take us into the wellbore coordinate system. And the last time we met, I worked up an example of that where, you know, I say I coded it up, but it really, I mean, it's just sort of, I calculatorized, right? I mean, it was not really any code in the sense of for loops or conditional statements. It was just basically typing the equations in, and then we worked an example. And you, in that example, I believe you saw that, you know, where we started with a diagonal matrix here, what comes out is not necessarily diagonal. Okay. So those rotations are done in Cartesian coordinates, right? But to evaluate a failure model, it's best to do it in terms of the wellbore. It's best to do it in polar coordinates, okay? So then we can take the components of the Cartesian matrix in the wellbore, and we can take it into polar coordinates. So these are the stress entries for the polar coordinates, okay? And then from that, we can evaluate the principal stresses. So the principal stresses are going to be two tangential stresses along the wellbore, and then sigma RR, which is at the wellbore wall, is just delta P, the difference in the pore pressure and the mud weight. Okay? So the two tangential stresses in terms of those components are just these guys. All right? And so your principal stresses will be these two, and sigma RR, or delta P. Okay? Now we have principal stresses in polar in the wellbore, in the polar coordinates, we can combine that with a failure model to determine when the wellbore will fail, okay? And this is where I'm going to skip over this one, but because I'm using lecture 19 slides. The ones I had prepared for lecture 20 are very similar. I had taken that slide out, okay? So then we're going to, then we introduce this hemispherical plot projection as a way to visualize different things we might want to plot in terms of their spatial location, the spatial location of the wellbore, right? So if you imagine this lower, this hemisphere, wherever a wellbore, if we were to drill a wellbore from the center down through it, from the center down into any orientation, the place where it crossed this lower hemisphere, we would plot, okay, in this space. So these contour lines represent different angles, right? So in the center, if the plot was in the center, this would be a vertical well. If it were all the way to the outside, it would be a horizontal well. This is a contour line of 30 degrees, 60 degrees, 90 degrees, okay? And then, of course, then the radial location is just northeast, south, or west, okay? So then using something like that, we can create plots like this, which would give us some indication. So in this case, this is an example of a deviated well, and the required delta P to maintain a stable wellbore. Okay, I think if you read the caption of this figure, in this term, in this case, it's actually this particular figure is. I can't remember. There's two figures. One is associated with compressive failure, right? That would be a more Coulomb type failure model, and then there's another one associated with drilling-induced tensile fractures, right? So that would be if you got too high of mud weight and you begin to hydraulically fracture, okay? So then the difference in those two kind of gives you your mud window, okay? And so then we can create this particular type of plot, and, you know, the areas, in this case, the white dot represents where this particular well was actually drilled, okay? And you can see that, you know, the delta P in this case is in this yellow region, right? And so that would, you know, it's sort of a high, in order to have a stable wellbore in that region, is sort of a high delta P. So I thought we'd go through the process of creating something similar to like that, this plot. However, so these are the slides that I intended to upload that somehow messed up. And so in this case, this is the required CO, right, the unconfined compressive strength in a more Coulomb model, right, on one of those lower hemisphere projection plots, right? So what this indicates, this is not necessarily in one-to-one correspondence with wellbore stability, because remember, wellbore stability is associated with the breakout width, right? A stable wellbore is one that doesn't wash out, right? There's some breakouts that are acceptable. But nevertheless, a plot like this can give you an indication of safe areas to drill, or, in other words, you know, if you were in this scenario, a normal faulting regime, and you were drilling in either of these directions, you'd have to have a very strong rock in those regions. So in other words, this is an indication of sort of where it's safe to drill and where it's not. Right? In the cool areas, the blues would be areas that are safe to drill. The red areas would be places that are not so safe to drill in terms of wellbore stability due to compressive failure. Okay. So you understand sort of how to read this. If I drill straight, almost, you know, vertical or with a slight deviation, then as long as the rock strength is greater than 90 or so megapascal, then we would have no breakouts at all. Right? So this is sort of the initiation of the first breakout would occur if the rock strength was less than 90. Okay, that doesn't mean, again, it doesn't mean that the wellbore would necessarily be unstable, but you would see some breakouts if the rock strength was worse than 90. However, if I were drilling in this direction, sort of northeast, at high angles of deviation, the rock would have to be much stronger in order to not have breakouts. Right? So I thought, we can do more, and actually for your homework assignment, you will do more that's closer related to the actual stability of the wellbore in terms of the breakout width. But in order to help you with that, I thought we'd sort of go through the process because some of the steps are the same.